so here we go. We're starting Daniel. We're on Daniel still. And last week we started the prophecy of Daniel chapter 9. Just real quick, what I told you was that was taking place during that time frame was that, by the way, we have some King James Bibles in the back. I'm reading and teaching out of the King James. If you happen to not have one, they're right there waiting for you. So just wanted to let you know that. Amen? All right. So we're teaching this Daniel prophecy out of chapter 9. And if you'll remember what I told you last week, you may not remember, Daniel was in prayer. Just real quick, as far as for the way that this timeline is up here, I kind of started with Joshua. So there's a lot of information or a lot of things that have taken place in the past back here. I didn't have room to put it on the timeline. Abraham's been called out, the nation of Israel, right? They spent time in Egypt as slaves, remember? And God brought them out on the Passover night. He delivered them through the Red Sea, which is spiritually is like our salvation. See, the truth of the matter is that you and I, born of Adam, were born in bondage to this world system, and we're born in bondage to Pharaoh. He's like the enemy of your soul. He wants to hold you in bondage as a slave. But God wants to deliver, amen, to set free. And just as that night they took that lamb and they cut its throat, they shed its blood, Jesus' blood was shed so that you and I could be delivered from out of the bondage of the world system, from out of the bondage of the spiritual Pharaoh, which is Satan. By the way, Pharaoh is a type of the Antichrist. We're not going to be there yet, but we're about to embark, really, because of where we are, on a series that's going to talk about the Antichrist. We're probably going to have to spend 2-3 weeks just talking about him, I'm thinking. But listen, it's important for you to understand that there's types of the Antichrist. As a matter of fact, I'm going to introduce this concept tonight. Out of 1 John in two different chapters, chapter 2 and chapter 4, it talks about the fact that there's many Antichrists, that there's a spirit of Antichrist, and that ultimately we also know, according to the book of Revelation and Daniel, that there will be a Antichrist. And so the fact is that the spirit of Antichrist has been on the earth. Ephesians chapter 2 says that you used to walk the course of this world. And he's talking, when he uses the personal pronoun, he's talking to people that have been saved out of the world system. Born of Adam, you, before you had your conversion, if you've been converted, were being moved upon, and you walked the course of the world. Whatever your course looked like. Some people's course look a whole lot worse than others. Look, my course didn't look good, all right? But the fact of the matter is that you used to walk the course of the world, and that you were being driven by the spirit, the prince of the power of the air, and the spirit of disobedience that works in the children of disobedience. And so there's a spirit of Antichrist that's been moving humanity in a certain direction. There's been many Antichrists, people who serve as types and shadows of the one who will come, and we're going to talk about him tonight. And then ultimately, once again, there will be the Antichrist that will show up in the end. All right, so whenever we talk about the Exodus from Egypt, I put up here the number one. Because Egypt is one of the first empires, and actually we're going to discuss, if we get through it in time, I'm going to try to be mindful of the time, 7, really 8 different empires that will have existed from the beginning until the end of time that are listed in the book of Revelation. The interesting thing about this seven-headed beast in the book of Revelation is that each one of these empires, and we're going to look at Daniel because he breaks it down for us, each one of these empires have something in common. And what they have in common is that they held Israel in subjugation, or they held Israel in bondage. They held Israel in captivity. They oppressed Israel, the people of God. Amen? Just as the enemy of your soul wants to do that to you and I spiritually, in a physical sense, they did that to Israel, all right? And the first ones were Egypt, amen? Whenever Egypt had Israel as slaves in bondage. The second ones took place right here in about 722 BC, the nation of Assyria. And the nation of Assyria took the northern kingdom. That's why I always draw these timelines and I repetitively tell y'all about these nations. So if it's the first time you've heard of it, listen, I repeat this information a lot just so that it's terminology that we become familiar with. You understand what I'm saying? Whenever you go to nursing school and they start talking about physiology and red blood cells and bone marrow that produces red blood cells, you don't have a clue what they're talking about. If I go to a welding shop and somebody starts talking about burning a certain kind of flux, I'm like, dude, I don't even know what a flux is. And sometimes when you hear terminology, that is a word, right? Did they use it in welding? I think it is. Anyway. Okay, cool. So it was something to do with that anyway. But the point that I'm trying to make is that whenever you come across new terminology, you sometimes feel lost. And the people used to talk to me about the fact that I was teaching the Bible in a way that people didn't understand. And I know I keep telling y'all this, but no, the problem is I'm just teaching the Bible. And sometimes there's terminology that we're not familiar with, but that doesn't mean we don't teach it. It doesn't mean if we're going to be disciples, that means to be a learner of Christ, that we have to come to that understanding. And these nations that I'm telling you about are a big part of end times revelation. The end times and the study of eschatology, or the end times of the Bible. Okay? And so it's important that we understand these things. So Assyria took over the northern part of the kingdom, the 10 northern parts of the tribes of Israel. Y'all remember whenever I taught y'all on multiple occasions how the kingdom was split in two? Many of you are familiar with that, correct? Solomon was disobedient. He didn't listen to the Lord. Because of that, God judged Israel. He split the kingdoms in two. 10 were in the north. 2, Benjamin and Judah, were in the south. The northern kingdoms were taken earlier in 722 BC by Assyria. The southern kingdoms were taken later in about 586 BC by Babylon first, the king of the north. Then there was a succession. We're about to read about it in Daniel, so I'm giving you a little bit of a preview. Then there was a succession of other kingdoms. We talked about this last week. Next came Medo-Persia, which is Persia is modern-day Iran. Babylon is modern-day Iraq. And then came Greece, Alexander the Great. And then Rome. In the end times, it talks about another kingdom, which is, it talks about 10 horns. All right? And then it also talks about the 8th kingdom coming from the 7th. This is the kingdom of Antichrist. But what we talked about was we were reading out of Daniel, and we were reading this particular prophecy. And what's happened is that where Daniel's reading this prophecy is right here. In this time frame where Persia is in control, really, of the known world of the East, and really trying to extend itself to the West. And so during this time frame, if you remember, Daniel was a young boy in Jerusalem, and he was taken captive. And I told you all a while back that it would have been as though they would have just showed up in your backyard and took your son and made him walk all the way to San Antonio. And that's when he was a young child. And so they took him all the way to Babylon, but now there's been a shift in the kingdom, and he's become an old man now. And now Persia is the empire that's in charge, or in control, if you will. There's been a shift in the physical. And Daniel's praying. He's saying a prayer because he knows that the time frame is shortening. Like, in other words, it's getting time now that God's about to release his people. And the reason he knows that is because there was a prophecy given by Jeremiah. Jeremiah the prophet, which predated Daniel, had been shown by God that the time of captivity would be about 70 years. And I read it to you last week, but I just want to read it again because I think that it's an interesting concept, that something that I feel like the Lord really wanted me to go, really today wanted me to share this with you. I wasn't going to do it. It wasn't in my notes, but I think I'm going to try to explain what I feel like the Lord's putting on my heart. In 2 Chronicles chapter 36, and you know, if you want to turn there, you can, but I'm just going to read it for you, verses 20 and 21. It says, "And them that had escaped from the sword carried he away to Babylon." So that's talking about whenever they originally were taken captive by Babylon, talking about the southern kingdom, "where they were servants to him and his sons until the reign of the kingdom of Persia." So until the change that we just talked about took place. "Until the reign of the kingdom of Persia, to fulfill the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah, until the land had enjoyed her Sabbaths. For as long as she lay desolate, she kept Sabbath to fulfill the 70 years. Remember, I told you a score is 20 years. So 70 is 60 plus 10 is 70. 70 years to fulfill the Sabbaths. And what he's talking about is the Sabbath of the land. As a matter of fact, I'm going to turn to Leviticus real quick. If you got your Bibles and you want to turn with me, that's fine. I'm going to turn real quick to Leviticus chapter 25. God had a Sabbath for the week. Amen. It was the first day of the week, which was what we call Sunday. It was Saturday, the Sabbath. And so Sunday is the first day of the week. The Sabbath was the last day of the week, the seventh day. And whenever that was the day of rest. God created for 6 days, then he rested. The whole point to the Sabbath, though, wasn't that God needed rest. The whole point was to point man to the fact that he was providing rest. And ultimately, Jesus is our Sabbath. You need to understand that. As a preacher, I got to tell you, I want you to show up to church on Sunday. But the fact of the matter is that you're not respecting what many people in the church would call, you know, not forsaken, you know, about the Sabbath, and that now the Sabbath is fulfilled by you showing up to church on Sunday. No, Jesus is your Sabbath. Your faith in Christ and your learning to rest in him is your Sabbath rest. Amen. But when you get a hold of the revelation of what Jesus has done for you and how he set you free, and when he died and paid the penalty for your sin, you're going to want and have a desire, amen, to come to the house of God to hear the word of God and to allow it to have its effect in your life. All right, Leviticus chapter 25. But not only was there a Sabbath for the week, there was also a yearly a Sabbath of years. Every seventh year was called a Shemitah, and then there was seven sevens of that. So every 49th through the 50th year was a Jubilee. All right, and the Jubilee was a big deal. That also represented the fact that God was going to provide freedom for his people. On the Jubilee year, really on the seventh year, and also specifically the Jubilee year, if a person had become, if they were a Hebrew and they had become a slave, Then they were on that Jubilee year, they were released from any servitude that they still owed. In other words, if you were a slave when the year of Jubilee came, if you were a Hebrew and you were owned by another Hebrew, they had to release you and let you go. And the only way that you could stay is if you wanted to. And the way that you would stay is, you remember I told you all that, you'd put your ear to the doorpost and you'd take an awl and you'd drive it through your ear and you'd wear an earring. And you put an earring in your ear, and what it showed was is that I'm not going anywhere. My master's too good. And Paul, in the book of Romans, whenever he wrote the book of Romans, he said, I'm Paul, a bondslave of Jesus Christ. He was referring back to the Old Testament bondslave. In other words, he's saying, where would I go? I put my ear to the doorpost and I drove it through with an awl because Jesus got a hold of my heart and he revealed himself to me. Amen. So I want you to know that there's a Sabbath for the week, there's a Sabbath of 7 years, and then there was a Sabbath of 7 years, of seven sevens. And so the Sabbath of the seventh year in Leviticus 25, I'm going to read it real quick. It says, and the Lord spoke unto Moses in Mount Sinai, saying, speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, when you come into the land which I give you, then shall the land keep a Sabbath unto the Lord. 6 years you shall sow your field, and 6 years you shall prune your vineyard and gather in the fruit thereof. But in the seventh year you shall be a Sabbath of rest unto the land, a Sabbath for the Lord, that thou shalt neither sow your field nor prune your vineyard. That which grows of its own accord of thy harvest thou shalt not reap, neither gather the grapes of thy vine undressed, for it is a year of rest unto the land. And the Sabbath of the land shall be meat for you, for thee, for thy servant, and for thy maid, and for thy hired servant, and for thy stranger that sojourns. In other words, he's saying, listen, when I bring you into the land, you're going to trust me. You're going to trust me in that seventh year. The number seven is God's number of completion and fulfillment. You're going to trust me. I created 6 days and I rested. Now you're going to learn how to rest in me. And it's the same thing for your walk spiritually today. I can preach all revelation day long. But if I don't tell you this before you leave, you need to understand something. Jesus is your rest day. Amen? Amen. You got to learn how to trust that what God provided was enough. You find yourself in the midst of a struggle. You find yourself in the midst of circumstances that you just can't seem to get free from, and you don't know how to get free. I'm here to tell you, you need to keep your faith in God's plan. And God's plan was the sending of his only begotten Son to die on the cross to pay the penalty of your sin. Not just so that you can be forgiven. Hold on a second. See, that's where people get confused. They think the cross is only about forgiveness so you can go to heaven. No, the cross is also about forgiveness so you can have access to grace. Amen. Now, hallelujah. Not just forgiving grace, empowering grace. Amen. You're no match for the devil. You're no match for a spiritual warfare. You don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness and heavenly places. God has given you and I access to grace to give us strength so that we don't have to continue repeatedly down our roadway of failure. Lord, help us. Amen? All right. He wants to be your Sabbath. What you trying to say, preacher? I'm trying to say most people in the church are trying to work towards their victory.
Right.
They're trying to read more, go to church more, pray more, fast more. And listen, I'm not saying you shouldn't read, pray, fast, and go to church.
Amen.
I'm saying if you think you can earn victory,
right,
the preacher lied, and he might not have done it on purpose. He just didn't know any better.
Amen.
But I'll tell you what my professor told me at Bible college. It doesn't matter if someone preaches the gospel in error on purpose or on accident. The result is the same.
Amen.
It leads to failure instead of freedom.
That's right.
Jesus is your rest.
Amen.
Keep your faith focused on Him and His work. Through that, it gives you a position of righteousness. In your position of righteousness, you're given grace. Grace empowers you to walk a life worthy of the Lord. Amen. You can't get it done, sir. Amen. Jesus did it for you.
Yes,
hallelujah. Now trust in Him. Hold on to Him and let Him have His way in your life. All right, we're talking about a Sabbath. Don't mess with the land. Trust me when you come into the land. He goes on to say in verse 7. Well, let's go ahead and look at verse 8. And you shall remember 7 Sabbaths of years unto thee. 7 times 7 years, and the space of 7 Sabbaths of years shall be unto thee 49 years. Does that make sense? 7 times 7 is 49. So 7 sets of 7 years. And what is that? Verse 9. Then shall you cause the trumpet of the Jubilee to sound on the 10th day of the 7th month. So in the 7th month, that's a big thing. We talked about the feast a while back. The 7th month is Tishri. There's 3 Jewish feasts in Tishri. The first one is the Feast of Trumpets, which occurs on the first day of the month, if I'm not mistaken. The second one is this one here. It's the Day of Atonement. It takes place on the 10th day of the month. And then lastly is the Feast of Tabernacles, which takes place on the 15th day of the month. But listen to what's happening here. On the tenth day of the 7th month, they're to sound the trumpet. This is now, let's be clear here. This is the 49th year on the 10th day of the 7th month. So every 49 years on the 7th month, on the 10th day, they blow a trumpet on the Day of Atonement. And they proclaim a jubilee. They proclaim a jubilee and they say, hey, all the slaves are set free. And I got to tell you that it's not an accident that He chose the Day of Atonement. Why? Well, I've taught you this a million times. Because on the Day of Atonement was the day that they took really 2 goats. And with these 2 goats, they laid their hands on the goats. And what they would signify transference of guilt from the sinner to the goats. One of the goats they took and they threw, they led him away, and he was called the scapegoat. They let him go into the wilderness, never to be found again. Representative of the fact that our sin was placed on Jesus and God has forgotten it. Amen?
Amen.
Number 2, the second goat was the one that was transferred to Him. He was the guilty goat, and He's the one that got His neck slit. He's the one that His blood was shed. But ultimately on the Day of Atonement, what took place was the high priest, after offering blood for his own sin, would take blood and he would go behind the veil and he would sprinkle that blood on top of the mercy seat. You remember that? The mercy seat was that covering that sat on top of the ark, and underneath was the law, the 10 commandments. Let me ask you a question. Did you keep all the 10 commandments?
No.
Come on, somebody. No, of course you didn't. None of us have. Because even if you went through the first 9 or first 8 when it said don't covet your neighbor's goods and don't covet your neighbor's wife, at some point in time you did that. Because Jeremiah said the heart of man is deceitfully wicked, and who can know it? And so if we're honest with ourselves, we thought the wrong things, we desired the wrong things, we're altogether undone. But hallelujah, God loves us, and He sent His precious Son for His blood to be shed. And this Day of Atonement was representative of that day. But every 49 years, it was a special day, an even more special day, because it was also the Jubilee. And that trumpet was sounded, and the blood was put on the mercy seat, and all the slaves were set free. But this is the problem. Whenever Israel went into the land, they didn't do what God told them to do. Instead, they went after foreign women, and they followed after foreign gods, and they didn't keep the Sabbath of the land. They tilled the land every 7th year. Why would I trust in the rest of the Lord when I can work another year and I can make more money and I can provide? And so all of that time, God, because of what they did, allowed them to go into captivity. And according to 2 Chronicles 36, He said, it's going to be 70 years, because if I keep you locked up for 70 years, I know the ground will lay unfallowed. I'm going to get my Sabbaths out of you some kind of way. I just keep you locked up and I keep you out of trouble. I keep you in your bondage over there. That way you can't put a plow in my ground because it's my ground. Now, I wanted to say all of that because I saw some interesting things in Daniel. Daniel chapter 9 is where we are. And we're talking about this prophecy. So Daniel now is in the time frame of Persia, and he's praying because he knows that the 70 years is nearly up. So we're all on the same page, right? That was explained okay, right? Y'all with me, right? All right, good deal. And so Daniel's praying, and all of a sudden, in the middle of the time frame of this prayer, it says, verse 21, it was about the time frame of the evening oblation. That means the evening sacrifice, about 3 o'clock our time, p.m., all of a sudden, the angel Gabriel swoops down and touches him. And then he tells him, hey, he says at the beginning of verse 23, at the beginning of your supplications or your prayers, the commandment came forth, and I am come to show thee, for thou art greatly beloved. Therefore, understand the matter and consider the vision. 70 weeks are determined upon your people and upon the holy city to finish the transgression and to make an end of sins, and to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. I'm not going all the way back in all of that, but I'm going to tell you what I am going to do. I'm going to remind you of what the 70 weeks represented. What we said was that it was actually 70 sets of 7 years. Remember? And what we said was that that equaled out to 490 years. Now, I'm just going to tell you right now that I found something that I thought was a little bit interesting. I did read another commentator that said it, but the truth of the matter is that I Googled it afterwards because I felt like the Lord was showing me this. That, first of all, the number 49 represented what we just talked about, the year of Jubilee, right? And it's almost as though this 490, 77s is representing a larger time frame of a bigger Jubilee. In other words, what I'm trying to tell you is that according to what this prophecy, if what I'm telling you is right about this prophecy, this last 70th week doesn't end till the end of this 7-year tribulation. So in some way, shape, or form, Israel still hasn't really received its fulfillment of its final jubilee. Does that make sense? In other words, they're not really free like they desire to be free. They think they are, but they've rejected Messiah. Because they've rejected Messiah, there's a whole lot of things that are going on for Israel right now. One of them being the Dome of the Rock, that Muslim mosque still sits on near the Temple Mount. Okay? So they're not really free. They're not serving God the way that they're supposed to. What I'm trying to say is this, though, is that at the end of this time frame, I believe that what God's showing us is that, yes, the first 7 years was a form of captivity to get back his Sabbaths like he wanted to, but that this is also a form of a big jubilee, if you will, that he's ultimately going to fulfill at the end of this last 70-week prophecy. Amen? And I'm going to show you why I believe that. Right here in verse 24, it says right here, and to make reconciliation for iniquity. Y'all see that right there in verse 24? Daniel 9, 24. To make reconciliation for iniquity. Alright? That word reconciliation right there. This was interesting to me. Reconciliation. I'm not even going to write the whole thing, but you know what it is in the Hebrew is this word right here. Kippur. It's where we get the word kippur. For Yom Kippur. What is that? It's the Hebrew word for the Day of Atonement. So whenever it's talking about right here, it's saying that this word reconciliation is the same word for atonement, and it means a covering. Just like on the Day of Atonement, whenever the blood of the Lamb was placed on top of the mercy seat, it covered. Amen? Do you remember what I told you what the mercy seat looked like? It had two angels on top of it. Have y'all ever seen a picture? Get on the tech people. We need to get our TVs up so we can have some pictures. Amen? Tech people aren't even here. But listen, we need to pray them in. What happened on the mercy seat was that there was an angel that was, they were called cherubim, and their faces were towards one another, but they were also towards the mercy seat. And they were looking down upon the mercy seat. And inside was the law. And that's what I was going a while ago. All of us have broken the law. Israel had broken the law. But once a year when the blood was placed on the mercy seat, the angels were no longer looking at the broken law. Instead, now they're looking at the mercy seat that's been covered with the blood of the Lamb. The word reconciliation means to bring in reconciliation for iniquity, to cover it up. At the end of the 70 weeks, the final jubilee is going to take place. The trumpet will have sounded, amen. And the final jubilee and the final day of atonement, when Jesus comes back, his presence literally with his people, and Israel no longer rejects him as Messiah, but instead they look upon the one whom they pierced, Zechariah chapter 12, and they mourn for him as one who mourns for an only son, and they receive him as their Messiah. That's what I'm trying to tell you, amen. That's part of this prophecy that's going on here. All right. But I want to back up a little bit. I want to talk to you about this word transgressions. Somebody questioned me after last week because of a respectable commentary, and they were wanting to know why I thought that the transgression had more to do with the fact that the Muslims were still in Israel than it did about Jesus coming back. And I want you to know, no, it has to do with Jesus coming back also. Amen. But let's take a look real quick. Let's go ahead and go back to Daniel chapter 8. And let's try to get a little bit of an understanding on why the preacher would say something about the transgressions having to do with Gentiles being on Jewish property also. All right? So that's what I want you to know before we even get started is this is the immediate context. And this is a lot of information I'm about to give you, but so far everybody looks like you're with me. And I think we're all okay. All right. Daniel chapter 8, starting in verse 3. Daniel says, "Then I lifted up mine eyes, and I saw, and behold, there stood before the river a ram, which had two horns, and the two horns were high, but one was higher than the other, and the higher came up last." Now, what does that mean? Well, just go ahead and come over here, turn your page, if you got the same Bible I do, and go to verse 20 of chapter 8, and I want to show you something. Daniel ends up giving the interpretation right here. "The ram which you saw having two horns are the kings of Media and Persia." All right, so I want you to see here that we're not playing guesswork. Daniel actually told us what it was. All right, then he goes on in verse 21. He says, "The goat is the king of Grecia," which is Greece. All right, so I want you to see that before while we're talking about this. That it says right here, "The ram which had two horns." It was the Medo-Persian Empire. So he doesn't even mention Babylon in this vision, all right? But he starts off with Medo-Persia. Now, the Persian part of there was an alliance between these two nations. And the Persian part of it, modern-day Iran, at the end became stronger. That's why one horn was larger than the other one. And it said that it grew up larger at the end because it became stronger and it dominated, all right? But then it goes on to say this. It says in verse 4, "I saw the ram pushing westward," so that's the nation of Persia, right? "I saw the ram of the nation of Persia pushing westward and northward and southward so that no beast might stand before him." I find it interesting too, this kind of hit me in my spirit today, that Daniel keeps calling these nations beasts. And you know, I want you to see that because when we get to the book of Revelation, the beast is literally a group of nations, and it's really speaking of this same kind of concept here, all right? It says right here, it says that no beast might stand before him, neither was there any that could deliver out of his hand, but he did according to his will and became great. And as I was considering, behold, a he-goat came. Now, I just told you that was Greece. A he-goat came from the west. Greece was to the west of Persia. Remember how I've drawn the map before? Israel's over here. The Sea of Galilee, this Jordan River, the Dead Sea, and then the edge right here, the Mediterranean Sea's here. Greece is way over here to the west. Persia, Israel, Iraq, all that stuff's over here to the east. So they're trying to push westward, but this goat comes from the west. And from the west on the face of the whole earth, he touched not the ground, and the goat had a notable horn between his eyes. Not touching the ground describes the fact that he moved with rapidity. He moved very fast. There's another vision that he says in chapter 7, which we're going to talk about also, where Greece is likened to a leopard. and because a leopard is also fast. Because Alexander the Great drove his army at great speed and conquered the whole known world in such a matter of time that it baffled the mind. Nobody could, they just weren't ready. They couldn't handle it because he just overwhelmed them so rapidly. All right? Now, Daniel's prophesying all this before it happened. Okay? He came to, well, listen, let me be clear. Babylon has already been in existence, and they've already been defeated by Persia when Daniel's seeing this. But Greece hasn't come yet, nor Rome. He's about to talk about Rome here in a little bit. Maybe not in this one, but in the next one. And he came to the ram that had two horns. So the goat came to the ram that had two horns, which I had seen standing before the river, and ran unto him in the fury of his power. And I saw him close unto the ram, and he was moved with choler, which means great anger, against him, and smote the ram, and broke his two horns. And there was no power in the ram to stand before him, but he cast him down to the ground and stamped upon him. And there was none that could deliver the ram out of his hand. Therefore the he-goat waxed very great. And when he was strong, the great horn was broken. The great horn was Alexander the Great. When he became strong, he died at the epitome of his career, if we would call it that. He was a young man. I can't remember the name. I'm shooting from the hip. I want to say 32, 31, something like that. Of a very, very young age, and he died suddenly. Some people, I think maybe he had pneumonia or something like that, and he just rapidly died. As fast as he conquered, he died. And so the horn was broken, and for it came up four notable ones toward the four winds of heaven. Now, you got to get a hold of this now. Let me take a little break here and tell you something. Scholars, do you understand that there's two forms of biblical scholarship? What I mean is, you have evangelical scholars, people like the Baptists, people like Pentecostal, people that are evangelistic in their nature, who believe in the inspiration of the Scripture. And these scholars, there's no question in their mind, they've done the research, Daniel was written B.C. Daniel was written, you know, there's no question. Liberal scholars, who are of a persuasion that don't really, I don't even know why they went to school for this. I do know why. It's because they want to discount the Bible. Right. They don't believe in the inspiration of Scripture. And what they have come to the conclusion is that there's no way Daniel could have been written B.C. because there's no way he could have prophesied and predicted these things with such accuracy beforehand. But this is the thing. Whenever that little boy was walking around in near the Qumran caves in Turkey, and he was throwing those rocks inside those caves, and he heard the breaking of clay pots, they went and checked and they found the Dead Sea Scrolls. They found writings that had evidence that Daniel was written B.C. So it messed them all up because they don't understand that God is real and he finds a vessel that he would speak through, and he spoke through Daniel, and Daniel saw in advance Alexander the Great doing what he did, his horn broken, and this is the craziest thing. When Alexander the Great died, his empire was taken over by four of his generals. So the big horn was broken, and four other horns came up. And so what I wanted you to see there was that it goes on to say this, and out of one of them came forth a little horn. Now, I got to tell you that ultimately that little horn is descriptive of the Antichrist. In the end, the little horn is the Antichrist. But I also want you to know that this was fulfilled by a literal man then. It was fulfilled by one of the generals of Alexander the Great. His name was Antiochus Epiphanes. That's a big old name, right? Antiochus. Now, the reason remember, we're talking about transgression right now. And why I'm talking about the fact that the word transgression means the Gentiles. The person that asked the questions, not here, but hopefully they'll watch the video. Antiochus Epiphanes. All right? And so one of these generals was Antiochus Epiphanes. And this is what it says right here. The little horn, verse 9, which waxed exceedingly great toward the south and toward the east and toward the pleasant land, meaning Israel, and it waxed great even to the host of heaven, and it cast down some of the host and of the stars to the ground and stamped upon them. Look at this. Yes, he magnified himself even to the prince of the host. In other words, he magnified himself as God, and even said, I am God, and I desire to be worshipped. Now that's a type of the Antichrist. And this is a perfect picture of what the Antichrist is going to do. I don't know that there's a better picture than Antiochus Epiphanes of what the Antichrist literally is going to do in the end days when he exalts himself, okay, and he magnifies himself as God. Now, listen, this is the thing. There's many prophecies that have a rule, what you call a rule of double reference. In other words, there was one fulfillment that took place then, and there's another one that would take place in the end. The reason that we know that this is going to happen again and that it wasn't completely fulfilled here is because Jesus said in Matthew 24, he said, when you see what the prophet Daniel spoke of, the abomination that causes desolation, then you need to be prepared and you need to run because it's coming. And this is what he's talking about. The abomination that causes desolation is going to be when the Antichrist puts himself in the temple of God and he elevates himself as God to be worshipped. And that's what Antiochus Epiphanes did. As a matter of fact, let's go on and read it. It says, and a host was given to him. And this, a host is another word for like an army. It can also talk about an army of angels. But in this case, I believe it's talking about an army of men. Against the daily sacrifice by reason of transgression. See, there's that word transgression. And it cast down the truth to the ground, and it practiced and prospered. Now listen, this is what Antiochus Epiphanes literally did. He came into Jerusalem, and he told the Jewish people that they were no longer going to circumcise their boys, so they could no longer have covenant. He called himself Theos Epiphanes, God manifest. So he literally called himself God and said, you're going to worship me. And then he took a swine, a pig, and he offered it up on the altar. And that's what they were talking about. They called it a desolation. It was an abomination that caused desolation. And so they thought that when that happened, and I don't have time to get into the time frame of the Maccabees, but they thought that that was what Daniel was talking about. And that was a partial fulfillment. But Jesus said it's coming again. Jesus said it's coming again, that there's going to be a man that's going to elevate himself and he's going to be desire to be worshipped as God himself, all right? And so what I wanted you to see is that that's where the word transgression came. So the literal context that we're talking about has to do with these Gentile people that started transgressing the land of Israel then. And what I'm trying to tell you is that it hadn't stopped even till today. The fact of the matter is that the Muslims still sit inside Jerusalem. And so that's the point I wanted to make. Now, the truth is that whenever Jesus comes back, and they see him, like I told you in Zechariah 12, and they receive him as their Messiah, then it's going to, that transgression is going to stop because the holy city is going to belong to Jesus, amen, and he's going to rule and reign from there. But not only that, their transgression for denying Messiah and their transgression from all those years of when they didn't walk in covenant with God, all that's going to be taken care of because they're finally going to be able to, they're going to finally accept God's plan. Does that make sense? All right, so I wanted you to see, that's a big thing. It's a lot of information about Antiochus Epiphanes and about Alexander the Great and those four generals. But you know what? It's some good information about end time stuff, and at least you've been introduced to it now. And so now I want to move on with the Daniel 9 prophecy. And it says here, verse 25, know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. Now, last week I told you that what that meant was the 62 weeks was 62 plus 7 more weeks is 69, correct? And the total prophecy is 70, right? So that means that there's 1 week left, okay? So let's go back and let's remind ourselves of what we said. This is a lot of intense stuff, right? Y'all still with me? Y'all look like y'all are awake. Come on, bite your lip or something. Don't fall asleep on me. All right. It says right here that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and build Jerusalem, what did we say that was? We said that that had to do with the book of Nehemiah. Whenever the king said, go back and rebuild the walls, which happened in 444 B.C. From that day, I told you last week, it started a prophetic time clock. So it's like as soon as the king said, go back and rebuild the walls, click, a time clock started, a prophetic time clock, tick, 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 tick. And now we're waiting for the next event for that 69-week period to be ended, right? And the next event was till Messiah the Prince shows up. And what I told you that was the triumphant entry when Jesus showed up on that day, on that Palm Sunday. And at that point in time, he did not deny the fact that he was the king. He's Messiah, the anointed one, the prince, which literally means a leader, a ruler, a king. Jesus showed up on that day, and the Pharisees, the people were saying, "Hosanna to David." And they had palm branches on the ground, and he was literally riding on a donkey. Remember that? He was riding on the colt of a donkey, and that there was an empty donkey in front of him. And the empty donkey represented the fact that Israel was rejecting Messiah. And the next day, he cursed the fig tree. And what I want you to see, because I forgot to tell you last week, is that whenever Jesus dies on the cross, all this time frame until the tribulation period starts, all this time frame is known as the church age. Amen? Daniel's prophecy didn't see the church age. You remember what the prophecy was for? This is determined upon your people. 70 weeks are determined upon your people, Daniel. Who's Daniel's people? The Hebrew people. The vision did not see them. So that's why it split into 69 weeks from the time frame to rebuild the city until Messiah shows up, 69 weeks, then we've had 2,000 years of the church age going on, and then the last 7-week period starts the last 7 years of the Great Tribulation. Does that make sense? All right. And so it says, it goes on to say this, and after 62 weeks, shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself, and the people of the prince that shall come. Now listen, this is where, this is a big transition that's taking place. The people of the prince that shall come. This isn't talking about Jesus now. And let me tell you how you know that. Look what it says that he's going to do, the people are going to do. That shall come, shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof will be a flood. So now we're talking about a different prince. Okay? We're talking about, this is the Antichrist. So look, I want you to see, because we got to kind of slow down a little bit. We got to look at this. So, the 69 weeks now is up. The Messiah has been cut off, and that word in the Hebrew, cut off, literally means to be cut like a covenant animal. You know, in the Old Testament, the way that they cut covenant was that they would kill the animal, then they would cut it in pieces, and they would lay each side of the carcass separate, and they would walk through it. So, it's interesting to me that this terminology was used, that Messiah was going to be cut off, and the people weren't even prepared. They should have understood that he was going to be utilized like a covenant animal. And Israel, when Jesus showed up and they hung him on the cross, they still didn't see that he was the sacrifice that was prophesied in the book of Daniel. All right, but it says right here, and after this time, Messiah will be cut off, but not for himself. In other words, he didn't die for himself, amen? He died for the sins of the people. And the people of the prince that shall come. Now, who is the prince that shall come? We're about to get into that in just a second. All right? Y'all still with me? The people of the prince that shall come. Not the prince, but the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. Now, I got to tell you this. In AD 70, there was a general named Titus. He was a general of the Roman army. And you know what he did? He fulfilled the prophecy that Jesus said. Jesus said that because of your disobedience, because you did not see the day of your visitation, this temple is going to be knocked to the ground. He said there won't be one stone left unturned. AD 70, Titus, general of Rome, did exactly that. Leveled the temple. That's why, see, that was actually the second temple. Solomon built the temple, it was destroyed. There was another temple built during the time frame of Nehemiah. Okay, that was the one. That one was destroyed. And now Herod built the temple, which was the temple that was there during the time frame of Jesus. When he's standing up on the mount, he tells them, not one stone will be left unturned. Because they tried to rebel against God, well, they rebelled against God, the Roman Empire under General Titus leveled it to the ground. The people of the prince that shall come is talking about the Roman Empire. Okay, does that make sense? All right. And then it goes on to say this. So now let's look a little bit about this prince. I think we have some time. I know this is some deep stuff. We'll try to review some of it next week. Daniel chapter 7, verse 38. I'm sorry. Daniel 7, verses 3 through 8. Now, so we're talking about these empires again. Now, what I want you to see is this, is that Daniel never mentions Egypt over here, and he never mentions Assyria. And the only reason I put these two up here is because the book of Revelation, it doesn't call them by name, but it includes them in the number, okay? This time, Daniel's going to mention Babylon. It says right here in verse 3, and four great beasts, he uses that word again, beasts. I want you to remember that because we're about to go to the book of Revelation. Four great beasts came up from the sea, diverse one from the other. They were all different. The first was like a lion. This is Babylon. And it had eagle's wings. I beheld till the wings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth, and made stand upon the feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to it. And behold, another beast, the second, like to a bear, and it raised up itself on one side. So remember, when we talked about Medo-Persia, the first time it was a ram, remember? And one of the horns grew taller than the other one. This time the bear raises itself up on one side. This is talking about Medo-Persia right here. And it had three ribs in its mouth and between its teeth of it. And they said thus unto it, arise, devour much flesh. Verse 6. After this I beheld, and lo, another like a leopard, which had upon the back of it four wings. Remember that? The four horns. Now it's four wings. Of the fowl, the beast also had four heads. Remember the four generals. And dominion was given to it. Now this is where we're introduced to the Roman Empire. Now I want to show you this is important. This is very important when it comes to end times prophecy. After this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible, and strong exceedingly. And it had great iron teeth, and devoured and broke in pieces, and stamped the residue with the feet of it. And it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. So this is how we make the connection of the 10 horns in the book of Revelation that we're about to turn to the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire overwhelmed all of these previous empires that were before it. Daniel goes on to say, I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots, and behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things. Okay, that's talking about the Antichrist. Now let's turn to Revelation chapter 17. And there came one of the seven angels which had the seven vials, and he talked with me, saying unto me, come here, I will show unto you the judgment of the great whore that sits upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So first off, just notice that there's a connection between the kings of the earth and this harlot, if we should call her that. Maybe that's a little nicer. Okay. She's not nice. I'm just trying to dilute it a little bit because we've got a little couple of young people. But the fact of the matter is we ought to call her worse. What she is that she's false religion that starts back at the Tower of Babel. She's false. She's mystery Babylon. She was instituted by Nimrod, a corporate rebellion against God. I'm talking black magic. You want to get down to the nitty gritty? Look, on the surface, it's all the false religions that have ever existed, including the apostate church that we're talking about right now. They don't all know that they're preaching black magic. The fact of the matter is that most of them are just deceived by the spirit that's behind it. They've been caught and put into a slumber. They've been intoxicated by the harlot themselves. It's the doctrines of devils. The spirit expressly says that in the last days, some will depart from the faith and give heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. And listen, but they got scripture quoted in. The devil quotes scripture. The devil quoted scripture to Jesus. No, the gospel must be preached from the truth. Jesus is the answer, not just for salvation, but also for victory. And listen to me, you don't make it palatable and diluted so that people will appreciate it or want to eat it. No, you preach it the way that it's written so that it can deal with the people's hearts and they can make a choice whether or not they really want Jesus or not. The Lord told me, don't put your grubby fingers on my word, son. It's my word. I wrote it. Present it for the way that it's written. Now, if you want to pray for me, pray that my personality will get out of the way. Pray that Matt's personality will be changed. If that's what God wants to do, amen? That people don't hate Matt. But that instead the word of God, though, would still come forth for the way that it's written.
Amen?
Alright. Goes on to say, so there's a connection between the kings of the earth and Mystery Babylon. She's had them intoxicated. They've been in bed with her. That's what all this Illuminati stuff is about. That's just the modern day version of it, man. This stuff's been going on since the garden. In the day that you eat thereof, you will not die. Instead, you will know. Bing! Your eyes are open. Illumination. You've been illuminated. It's the occult version of being born again. It's called their initiation. They buy into what the liar has to offer, and they open up their third eye, the pineal gland behind the brain. That's what the occultists talk about.
Yeah. Yes.
This isn't anything new. Anyway. He goes on to say, he carried me away in the spirit, verse 3. Well, look at this, though. Part B of chapter, verse 2. And the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. I talked to you about this verse before. You ever been drunk before? How about you? But I know I have. I don't act right when I'm drunk. I can't see where I'm going. I don't hear right. I sure don't talk right. I don't think right. I'm lost, man. I can't see nothing. I don't know where I'm going. The inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of fornication. Can't see straight. Don't know where we're going. The world is in a mess. The church is in a mess. Goes on to say in verse 3, so he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet colored beast. There's that word again. Full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. You know, I'm going to say this. Would you do me a favor and take a little note? And would you Google, when you go home tonight, would you Google picture of the Vatican priests and cardinals? Go ahead and Google that. I want you to do that. You got it in your head? Google picture of the priests, of the Vatican priests and cardinals. And I want you to see what that picture looks like. And you just look at this. Because not only that, it goes on to say, and we're going to get there. I'm going to tell you this in a second. Having seven heads and 10 horns. Remember the 10 horns? Listen to me. There's a lot of good Catholic people. There's a lot of good Catholic people that probably are even born again. Some of them. But that don't mean that the system is right.
Amen.
That ain't the right Mary, man.
Amen.
You hear what I'm trying to tell you? The real Mary is not pleased with how they're portraying her. She did not co-redeem with Jesus. She was not born sinless like the Catholic Church teaches. Jesus isn't kept in a box on a wall. His presence lives in your heart.
Amen.
That piece of bread didn't turn into flesh when they do some hocus pocus mystery Babylon magic on that thing. No, the real Jesus said, you will eat my flesh and drink my blood, just as the children of Israel ate that Passover lamb. It's faith in him daily in what he did that gives you access to the grace of God.
Amen.
They changed it. It's not the same Jesus.
Amen.
And many people are lost.
Amen.
And they're lost in the midst of it's drunkenness.
Yes.
They can't see it.
Sure.
The word of God says man must be born again. And they teach that you're born again when they sprinkle you with water as a baby. Don't tell me they don't teach it, because I was sitting in there when they did my daddy's funeral, and I was able to preach the second half of it. He said, Jim was born in the waters of baptism as a baby when they sprinkled him. I said, no, my daddy, when I got up, I said, my daddy was born again when he accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior as an adult. Made a recognition. I'm a sinner. And I need a Savior in my heart.
Yes.
It wasn't just an intellect. It was a heart thing.
Amen.
It's got to happen in the heart.
That's right.
And if it doesn't happen in the heart, then it didn't happen.
That's right.
Goes on to say, 10 horns. The woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet, decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. Upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. Started at the Tower of Babel, I told you that. I saw the woman, she was drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered. In other words, I was amazed. With great admiration, the idea isn't that he respected it. The idea is that he was really confused. It was almost like he was just mesmerized by it. It's like, what is going on?
Yeah.
I mean, what? It goes on to say, verse 7, and the angel said unto me, wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell you the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carries her, which has the 7 heads and the 10 horns. The beast that you saw was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit, and go into perdition. We might try to talk about that next week. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life. Did you know that there's a book of life? Amen.
Amen.
I hope your name's written in the book of life, because you don't want to wonder whenever this thing shows up. And really and truly, I hope we're not here. Amen.
Amen.
Goes on to say, when they behold the beast that was and is not yet is, here's the mind which has wisdom. The 7 heads are 7 mountains on which the woman sits. Now, it's an interesting thing to know this. Google this too. If you got your pen, write it down. If you got it in your brain, that's good. So you're Googling two things. And then this next thing you're going to Google is Rome, the city built on 7 hills. And yeah, you can't make this stuff up. You hear what I'm trying to tell you? You just got to go digging and looking a little bit for it. Rome, the city built on 7 hills. You tell me what you find out. It goes on to say right here, 7 heads are 7 mountains on which the woman sits. There are 7 kings. 7 kings, 5 are fallen. So John is writing this vision from the Isle of Patmos. He's a prisoner on an island for preaching the gospel. Mm-hmm. While he's writing it, there's an emperor named Domitian, and it's the Roman Empire that's in control. He said, out of these 7 heads, 5 of them are already fallen. Egypt, number 1. Assyria, number 2. Babylon, number 3. Medo-Persia, number 4. Greece, number 5. Goes on to say right here, and there were 7 kings, 5 are fallen, I just named those 5. 1 is Rome, while he's giving the prophecy. 1 is, and the other is not yet come. Who's number 7? The 10 horns. 1 is not yet come. And then he goes on to say, and when he comes, he must continue a short space. Verse 11. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the 8th and is of the 7th and goes into perdition. So number 8 is the Antichrist, his kingdom, which comes from the 10 horns. Does that make sense? So what I'm trying to tell you is that the Roman Empire, when Daniel saw it, the Roman Empire in his vision, it had 10 horns connected to it. But the 10 horns had never come into existence yet. Does that make sense? Yeah. So the 10 horns are going to come from the revitalized Roman Empire, the area where it was before. Some of it's still alive. Little embers are still burning. We don't have time to get into all that. It never really, really died. It's still been on earth. But the point is that at the end, in this last week of Daniel's prophecy, the people of the prince that will come will destroy the city. So the people of the prince that will come was the Roman Empire, originally, that destroyed the city in AD 70. But the prince that will come is the Antichrist. He's number 8 that comes from the 10 horns that originally came from the old Roman Empire. Does that make sense?
Yes.
All right. And it says, the beast that was and is not, even he is the 8th and is the 7th, and is of the 7th, and goes into perdition. And the 10 horns which you saw are 10 kings, which have received no kingdom as of yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. These have 1 mind, and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. All right, let's go back to Daniel chapter 9, and see if we can try to close some of this up. So let's go back to verse 26. And after 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off. Jesus died, but not for himself. And the people, that's the Roman Empire, of the prince that shall come, that's talking about the Antichrist in the end, shall destroy the city. That's what Roman Empire did through Titus in AD 70. and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood. It's talking about destruction. And unto the end of the war, desolations are determined. Verse 27. And he, who's he? I got into a big old argument with a Jehovah's Witness elder over this. He was so mad at me by the time this conversation was over, he couldn't even see straight. You know what the word he is? It's a pronoun, right? A pronoun has what you call an antecedent. I'm not trying to get all fancy on you. I'm just trying to make a point. An antecedent refers back to the subject that was last spoken of. The subject that was last spoken of was the prince that shall come. He is connected to the prince that shall come. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. He shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. He tried to tell me that was Jesus. And that was actually what some of, to be fair to them, that was what some of the interpret. I want to make that clear. Some of the interpretations from the late 1800s and early 1900s of Bible scholars, of people, men that I've respected, some of the other stuff that they said, that's what they believed. And so I just want you to be aware of that. But it says, he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. So remember, this is the last week we're talking about. He's going to confirm a covenant. In reality, in my opinion, the big thing we should be looking for is not necessarily, and I might be wrong on this, just, you know, don't hold me to it. Not so much that we're expecting the trumpet to blow. Don't get me wrong, I'm looking for the blessed hope, and then we get raptured out of here. But my eyes are really, I haven't really been watching the news, so that's not true. But I'm at least keeping my ears open to hear whether I'm looking for a covenant to get signed. I'm looking for a covenant to get signed, a confirmation of a peace treaty with Israel. It doesn't mean that that's going to be the one right then and there, but I'm telling you, I'm looking real close, because to me, when that happens, that's signaling, in my opinion, more than anything, according to the prophecy, the beginning of this last week. The 70th week starts whenever that covenant is signed. I hope that the rapture takes place before that. And we're going to talk about it as we go forward. But what I'm trying to say is that according to this, it says in verse 27, he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week, and in the midst of the week, 3.5 years, he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease, just like Antiochus Epiphanes did. And for the overspreading of abominations, he shall make it desolate until the consummation, or until finality. And so essentially what I've tried to tell you is that, just a quick review, 70 weeks have been determined upon your people, Daniel. The first 69 weeks started whenever the edict or the decree was given by the king for Nehemiah to go back and to begin rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem, right? And that started a prophetic time clock, which lasted 444 years. This is the interesting thing. I told you this last week. But if you, when you do the math according to scholars, and you take that four, no, I'm sorry, it didn't last 40. It was 444 BC whenever he gave that decree. When you do the math and you do the conversion between the Hebrew calendar and the Gregorian calendar, which is the one we use now, scholars say that it came out to exactly 483 years from the day that that king gave the decree to rebuild the wall till Jesus rode into town on the donkey that day. 483 years, which is the first 69 weeks. 7 plus 60, plus 490 years is the total 490 years is the total of the 70 times 7. You subtract 7 from that, you come up with 483. When you do the math from the day that the decree was given to rebuild the city to the day that Jesus rode into town on that colt was 483 years. Leaving. Now that's just amazing. That doesn't that get you excited? Amen. And that there's a 7-year period that's left. And that from that period of time, known as the church age, that wasn't seen in Daniel's prophecy. But what we're told is that the last 7 occurs. He's going to sign a covenant with the people, and in the middle of it, he's going to break it. Amen.